Welcome to another example of network analysis using the critical path method. In this example, we have been given the activities of the project, which is from A to I, and we have been given the predecessors for each of these activities. We have also been given the duration in days for each of these activities. Now, let's try to draw a network diagram. Then we'll try to find the minimum time of completion of the project. And third, we'll identify the critical path. So let us first draw the network diagram. So this is the starting node. Now we have been given that A, B, and C do not have any predecessors. So these will start from the starting node. So this is A, and A takes 8 days for completion. This is B, which takes 10 days for completion. And this is C, which takes 8 days for completion. So we have completed A, B, and C. Now next is D and E, which are dependent on A. So let's draw this. So this is the ending node for A. And from here, let me draw D and E. Now D takes 10 days and E takes 16 days. So we have completed drawing D and E. Next is F, which is dependent on D and B. Okay, so D is here and B is here. So I think I'll have to change this. I'll take E, I'll draw E here and D here. And D and B are the predecessors for F. So I think both D and B will have to merge into one node, and then from there I can take out F. So let me first change these. So let me draw a node here. And then from this node, I can draw D, which takes 10 days. And from this node, because F is dependent on D and B, so from this node, I can then draw F, which takes 17 days. Now here I have to draw E, because E I had drawn earlier, but then I deleted it. So let me draw E here. E, which takes 16 days. So here we have completed F. Next is G and H, which are dependent on C. So let's draw that. So this will be the ending node for C. And from this I can draw G and H. G takes 18 days and H takes 14 days. So I've completed G and H. Next is I, which is dependent on F and G. So this is F and this is G. So let me draw the ending node for these. And from this node, then I can draw I, which takes 9 days. And since this is the last activity, it'll end in the finish node. So this is the finish node. Now these two activities, which is E and H, these also will end in the finish node, because there is no activity dependent on these two activities. So let me make that change. So this is E, which takes 16 days. And this is H, which takes 14 days. Now let's do the node numbering. This goes from left to right. So here we have completed step number one, which is to draw a network diagram. Now the next step is to find the minimum time of completion of the project. Now let's try to understand this. So here the question is to find the minimum time of the completion of the project. So if you look at the network diagram here, there are multiple paths from the starting node to the ending node, like AE, AC, GI, and so on. Now, the question is to find the minimum time of completion of the project. So you have to find the minimum time, but the time in which we are completing the project. So this doesn't mean the path which takes the least amount of time from the beginning to the end. This means the time within which the project will get completed. So the project will get completed when the longest path of the project gets completed. Now that is the minimum time for the project to complete. Of course, we can take more time if we want to delay the project. So the minimum time is the time taken by the longest path on the project, starting from the starting node and ending at the ending node, which in other words is also known as the critical path. So basically we have to find the duration of the critical path on this project. Now let's first find the earliest start, earliest finish, latest start and latest finish times for each of these activities. For activity A, the earliest start time is 0 because there is no other activity on which A is dependent. And since A takes 8 days to complete, the earliest finish time is 8. Now activity E is dependent on the completion of activity A. Now activity A completes on the 8th day. So activity E can start on the 8th day at the earliest. And since E takes 16 days to complete, the earliest activity E can be completed is 8 plus 16, which is 24. Now for activity B, again there is no activity preceding this activity. So the earliest start time for activity B is 0. And activity B takes 10 days to complete. So the earliest finish time for activity B is 10. For activity C, the earliest start time is again 0. And C takes 8 days to complete. So the earliest finish time is 8. Now for activity D, the earliest start is dependent on the earliest finish of activity A. So D can start on the 8th day at the earliest, and it takes 10 days to complete activity D. So the earliest finish time is 18th day. Now for activity F, the earliest start time is dependent on activities D and B. So F can start only when both activities D and B are complete. Now B completes on the 10th day, but D completes on the 18th day. So the earliest F can start is on the 18th day. And F takes 17 days to complete. So the earliest completion time for F is 18 plus 17, which is 35. Now activity G is dependent on the completion of activity C. So the earliest start time is 8 because activity C completes on the 8th day. And it takes 18 days to complete G. So the earliest finish time for G is 18 plus 8, which is 26. Now the earliest start time for I is dependent on the completion of F and G. So I can start only when both F and G are complete. Now the earliest finish time for F is 35, while for G it is 26. So the earliest I can start is on the 35th day. Now I takes 9 days to complete. So the earliest finish time for I is 35 plus 9, which is 44. For activity H, the earliest start time is dependent on C. So H can start on the 8th day because that is when activity C is complete. And it takes 14 days for H to complete. So 14 plus 8, which is 22, is the earliest finish time. Now we have found out the earliest start and earliest finish time for all the activities. Now let's do the latest start and latest finish time for these activities. So at this point, we know that the maximum time taken by any path from the beginning to the end is 44 days. So this becomes the minimum time of completion of the project, because this part takes 24 days and this part takes 22 days. So 44 is the maximum time taken by any path to reach to node number 6. So this is the minimum time of completion of the project, because it is up to the project manager to delay any of the activities and take it beyond 44 days. But definitely it will be very, very difficult to reduce the time from 44 days. So now, since 44 is the completion time of the project, we'll start with 44 days as the latest finish time, because for the latest finish time, we don't want to delay the project. And we want to find out how much can each of the activities be delayed by. So I, the latest finish time is 44, and 44 minus 9, which is 35, is the latest start time for activity I. Now activity E can also finish on the 44th day at the latest. And 44 minus 16, which is 28, becomes the latest start time. For activity H, again 44 is the latest finish time, and 44 minus 14, which is 30, becomes the latest start time. For F, the latest finish time is 35. This is because the latest start time for I is 35, and F has to be complete by 35th day for I to start on the 35th day. And the latest start time for F is 35 minus 17, which is 18. For activity G, again the latest finish time is 35. And the latest start time is 35 minus 18, which is 17. Now activity D is the predecessor to activity F. So activity D has to be complete by the time F starts, which is on the 18th day. So the latest finish time is 18. And it takes 10 days, so 18 minus 10, which is 8, is the latest start time. Now for activity C, The latest finish time is dependent on the latest start time of both activities G and H. Now C has to be completed at the latest by the time that any of the activities G or H has to start. So the latest finish time for activity C is the earliest of the latest start times of G and H. So activity G starts on the 17th day and activity H starts on the 30th day. So the earliest any of these two activities has to start is the 17th day. So C has to complete latest by the 17th day for activity G to start. And 17 minus 8, which is 9, is the latest start time. Now activity B is a predecessor to activity F. So the latest finish time for activity B has to be the latest start time for activity F, which is 18. And it takes 10 days to complete activity B. So 18 minus 10, which is 8, is the latest start time. For activity A, it is a predecessor of activities D and E. So the latest finish time for activity A has to be the time at which either of the two, that is E and D, have to start. So E has to start on the 28th day, but D has to start on the 8th day. So A has to complete by the 8th day for D to begin. So 8 is the latest finish time for A, and it takes 8 days to complete A. So the latest start time for activity A is 0. Now after we have found the earliest start, earliest finish times, and the latest start and latest finish times, let's try to find the earliest occurrence, latest occurrence, and slack of each of the events. So here we'll denote E, that is the earliest occurrence, L as the latest occurrence, and S as the slack. So for node 1, E is equal to 0, L is equal to 0, and S is equal to 0. So basically this means that it can occur at the 0th hour. Now let's try to find the earliest occurrence, latest occurrence, and slack for event number 2. Now the earliest occurrence and the latest occurrence times for event number 2 are dependent on the activities ending at this event. Now for event 2, only activity A is ending in this event. Now for the earliest occurrence time, we'll take into consideration the earliest finish times of the activities. So the earliest event 2 can occur is when activity A is completed at the earliest finish time. So E is equal to 8, and the latest occurrence of this event will happen when the activity A is completed on its latest finish time. So the latest finish time for activity A is 8. So the latest event 2 can occur is on the 8th day. And slack, as you know, is the difference between the latest occurrence and the earliest occurrence of the event. So slack here is 0. Now for event 3, there are two activities ending in event 3. First is B and second is D. So let's first find the earliest occurrence of event 3. Now for the earliest occurrence, we'll take into consideration the earliest finish time of activity B and D. Now the earliest event 3 can occur is the latest of the earliest finish times. So event 3 can occur only when both D and B are completed. Now D completes on the 18th day. This of course is the earliest finish time that we are considering, and for B, it completes on the 10th day. So 3 cannot happen before the 18th day. So earliest occurrence for 3 is 18. Now the latest event 3 can occur is dependent again on the activities B and D, but this time on the latest finish times. So B finishes the latest on the 18th day and D also finishes on the 18th day. So latest occurrence for event 3 is 18 and slack is L minus E, which is 0. Now event 4 is dependent on activity C. The earliest occurrence is the earliest finish time for activity C, which is 8. And latest occurrence is the latest finish time for activity C, which is 17. And slack is equal to 17 minus 8, which is 9. For event 5, the earliest occurrence and latest occurrence depend on activities F and G. Now the earliest occurrence time is the latest of 35 and 26, which is 35. The latest occurrence is the latest of 35 and 35, which is 35. And slack is L minus E, which is 0. For event 6, the earliest occurrence is dependent on E, I, and H. Now the earliest finish times for E is 24, for I is 44, and for H is 22. So the earliest occurrence for 6 is the largest number, which is 44. The latest occurrence is the largest number of the latest finish times, which is 44, 44, 44. And slack is 44 minus 44, which is 0. So here in this example, we have found out the earliest start and earliest finish time for each of the activities. We have also found out the latest start and latest finish times for each of the activities. And we have also found out the earliest occurrence and latest occurrence, as well as the slack for each of the events. Now, the third part of this question is to identify the critical path. Now, there are three methods to identify the critical path. So let's look at these methods one by one. So let's first take method one. Now, as we know that critical path is built on the critical activities. So it's a sequence of critical activities. And one of the attributes of the critical activities is that they cannot be delayed even by one day without delaying the entire completion of the project. So what this means is that the total float for these activities is zero. So method one is that we'll find out the total float of all these activities, and the activities which have a total float of zero will make the critical path. So let's list down the activities. And here we'll find the total float. So total float is defined as the latest start time of an activity minus the earliest start time, or the latest finish time minus the earliest finish time. So for activity A, the latest start time is 0 and the earliest start time is 0. So the total float is 0. For activity B, the latest start time is 8 and the earliest start time is 0. So 8 minus 0, the total float for B is 8. For C, 9 minus 0, so 9. For D, 8 minus 8, which is 0. For E, 28 minus 8, which is 20. For F, 18 minus 18, which is 0. For G, 17 minus 8, which is 9. For H, 30 minus 8, which is 22. And for I, 35 minus 35, which is 0. So the activities which have a 0 float is A, D, F, and I. So A, D, F, and I. These are the critical activities and this is the critical path. So if we look at this network diagram, so A, then D, then F, and then I. So it starts from the starting node and completes at the completion node, and these activities have a total float of 0. Now let's look at the second method. Now in the second method, we'll look at three conditions to find out the critical activities. The first condition is that the earliest occurrence time for the head event, that is the event touching the head of an activity, is equal to the latest occurrence time for the head event. So for the head event, the earliest occurrence time is equal to the latest occurrence time. So for head event, E is equal to L. Now the second condition is that the earliest occurrence time for the tail event, so the event which is at the starting point of the activity, is equal to the latest occurrence time of the tail event. So for tail event, earliest occurrence time is equal to the latest occurrence time. And the third condition is that the earliest occurrence time of the head event, let's say J denotes the head event. So for example, if we take the activity 1, 2, then J is 2 and I is 1. So earliest occurrence time of the head event minus the earliest occurrence time of the tail event, that is 1, which is I'm denoting as I, is equal to the latest occurrence time of the head event, which is J, minus the latest occurrence time of the tail event, which is I. So latest occurrence time of 2 minus the latest occurrence time of 1, and this is equal to the duration of the activity, which is, say in this example, it is 8. So T I J, so the time taken for the activity I J. So the activities which meet all these three conditions are known as the critical activities and will make the critical path. So let's identify which of these activities meet these criteria. So let's first take activity A. So A, first condition is for the head event, E is equal to L. So here E is equal to L. So the first condition is met. The second condition is for the tail event, E is equal to L. So tail event is 1, E is 0, L is 0. So this condition is also met. And the third condition is that the earliest occurrence of 2 minus the earliest occurrence of 1, which is 8, 8 minus 0, which is 8, is equal to the latest occurrence of 2 minus latest occurrence of 1, which is again 8 minus 0, which is 8, and this is equal to the duration of the activity, which is 8. So this is also met. So A is a critical activity. So let's note down A. Now let's look at B. So for B, the first condition for head event, E is equal to L. So E is 18, L is 18. So yes, this is met. For tail event, E is equal to L. So tail event is 1. So E is 0, L is 0. So this is also met. Now third condition is E J minus EI, so this is 18 minus 0, which is 18, is equal to LJ minus LI, which is again 18 minus 0, which is 18, which should be equal to TIJ, which is the duration of activity B. So duration is 10. So this doesn't meet. So the difference between the earliest occurrence of head event minus the earliest occurrence of the tail event is not the same as the duration of the activity. So B is not a critical activity. Now let's take C. So for C, for head event, E is equal to L. So this is the head event, that is event number 4. So E is not equal to L. So C is not a critical activity. So let me note down so that we can remember. So B is not, A is a critical activity, C is again not a critical activity. Now let's take D. So for D, the first condition is for head event, E is equal to L. So E is 18, L is 18. So yes, this is met. For tail event, E is equal to L. Tail event is event number 2. So E is 8, L is 8. So yes, this is also met. Third condition is EJ minus EI, so 18 minus 8, which is 10, is equal to LJ minus LI, which is again 18 minus 8, which is 10, and this should be equal to the duration of the activity, which is 10. So this is met. So D is a critical activity. Next one is E. So the first condition is for head event, which is event number 6. E should be equal to L. So E is 44 and L is 44. So this is met. Second condition is for tail event, E is equal to L. So E is 8 and L is 8. So this is also met. And third condition is EJ minus EI is equal to LJ minus LI. So E is 44 and for tail event, E is 8. So 44 minus 8 is 36, and LJ is 44 and LI is 8. So 44 minus 8, which is again 36. And the third is TIJ, which is duration. So duration is 16. So E minus EJ minus EI is 36, LJ minus LI is 36, but TIJ is 16. So this is not met. So E is not a critical activity. Now the next activity is F. So for F, for head event, E is equal to L. So E is 35, L is 35 for the head event, which is event number 5. So this is fine. Second condition is for tail event, E is equal to L. So tail event is event number 3. E is 18, L is 18. So this is also met. Third condition is EJ minus EI, which is 35 minus 18, which is 17, should be equal to LJ minus LI, which is again 35 minus 18, which again is equal to 17, and that should be equal to the duration of the activity. So duration is 17. So yes, this third condition is also met. So F is a critical activity. Now let's look at activity G. So first condition is for head event, E is equal to L. So head event is 5. So yes, E is equal to L. Second condition is for tail event, E is equal to L. So tail event E is 8, L is 17. So this is not met. So this is not a critical activity. Let's now take, so G is not a critical activity. Let's now take H. H, the head event is 6. And for head event, E is equal to L. For tail event, event number 4 is a tail event for activity H. E is equal to L, but E is 8 and L is 17. So this condition is not met. So H is not a critical activity. Now next, let's take I. Now for I, the first condition, E is equal to L for head event. Head event is event number 6. So E is 44, L is 44. So this is met. Second condition is for tail event, E is equal to L. The tail event is event number 5. So E is 35, L is 35. So this is also met. Now third condition, EJ minus EI. So 44 minus 35 should be equal to LJ minus LI, which is 44 minus 35. So yes, EJ minus EI is equal to LJ minus LI, which is 44 minus 35 or 9. And that should be equal to the duration of the activity. Duration of the activity is 9. So third condition is met. So I is a critical activity. So from this, what we found is the critical activities are A, D, F, I. So A, D, F, and I. So this is the result that we got with method 1 also. Now let's look at the third method. Now another method for finding out the critical path is to take all the combinations of activities from the starting node to the ending node, finding the duration of these activities, and whichever path has the maximum duration is the critical path. So let's try that method. So let's take the path 1, 2, 6 or AE. So it starts from node number 1 and E ends at node number 6. So AE. Now A takes 8 days and E takes 16 days. So 8 plus 16, which is 24 days. Next possible combination is A, D, F, I. So A, D, F, I. So this is 8 plus 10 plus 17 plus 9, which is equal to, so 8 plus 10 is 18, 18 plus 17 is 35, 35 plus 9 is 44. So 44 days. The next possible combination is B, F, I. So this is 10 plus 17 plus 9. So 10 plus 17 is 27. 27 plus 9 is 26. Sorry, 36. Now the next possible path is C, G, I. So this is 8 plus 18 plus 9. So 8 plus 18 is 26 plus 9 is 35. Another possible combination is C, H. So this is 8 plus 14. So 8 plus 14 is 22. So these are all the possible combinations of paths from the starting node to the ending node of the project. Now out of these, let's find out the path which takes the maximum duration, which is this path, which is taking 44 days. So ADFI, this is the critical path. And of course, we know that the duration of the completion of the project is 44 days. So these are the three ways in which we can find out the critical activities and the critical path.